السنن الرواتب are recommended sunnahs as far as our prayer is concerned. So in this regard, one important prayer is a Salatul Witr. So first of all, I would like to put a few points as a preface. Number one, deen or belief in something, that's a natural requirement of human being. And that's why human being all over the world, they do believe in something, maybe divine or fabricated, but they need it. Point number two is that faith must be in something came down from the heaven, which is called a divine concept. That is point number two. Point number three is the purpose of that deen or religion is to get connected to the Creator. That's point number three. Point number four is that these ways how to get connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may be shown by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's point number four. Point number five is that these ways may be shown through someone who is receiving message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is called the Prophet or the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. That is number one. Now the second paragraph is that in this regard, as we mentioned, faith is must, then faith and belief has its own requirements, and these requirements are called deeds and actions, and these deeds and actions are of two types. Number one, in connection to your Creator, and number two, in connection to your fellow human being. Our subject for today is in connection to your Creator. In connection to your Creator, that is called ibadat in general term. But these ibadat, as we mentioned, that is based upon aqeedah. So that's why we started with kalima, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. But after kalima, which is a faith and belief on one hand, deed and action on the other hand, the next or the following important issue is the practice of prayer. So prayer, that is such an important thing in deen. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, As-salatu imaduddin. Prayer is the backbone of the structure of Islam. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلَمٌ وَعَلَمُ الْإِيمَانِ الصَّلَاةِ. Everything is known through its very much known sign. The known sign of Iman is prayer. And that's why that is called شِعَارُ الْإِسْلَامِ, are the sign of Islam. That's another point. And number three is, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that on the day of judgment, the first ever thing a Muslim has to be asked and questioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a prayer. So the first ever in number mean it will accredit your position. If your prayer is okay, so it means that you have a good credit. Later on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will consider your actions and deeds. If that credit is not good, so maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will throw away your paper, that we are not going to consider any good action of yours. That's another important point. Now, as far as the case of prayer is concerned, that prayer, Sahaba Rizwanullah, that's important. Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, they used to look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he is doing. When they saw the Prophet, he was doing something, they started doing the same. They were not making or saying any if and buts. They saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doing something, they started the same. Because as far as the terms are concerned, faraz, wajib, sunnah, nafal or mustahab, these terms are not Islamic terms. These are academic terms. For academic purpose, in jurisprudence, we use it. This is faraz prayer. This is sunnah. This is wajib. This is mustahab or nafal. Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, they were not making any difference in this regard. Prayer is prayer. They saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they started the same. But later on, based on jurisprudence, the fuqaha and the jurist, they categorized it that this prayer is faraz, this one is sunnah, this one is wajib, and this one is nafal. Got it? Now the next point is that in Islamic jurisprudence, there are a few terms. Number one, faraz. So what is faraz and how? It has to be defined, or it is defined by the jurist. Huwa ma talaba shar'u fi'lahu talaban jaziman bidalilin qat'iyyin la shubhata fihi. That is such a practice which the Sharia ordered certainly without any doubt or confusion therein. Number two, wajib. Huwa ma talaba shar'u fi'lahu talaban jaziman walakin bidalilin zunniyin fihi shubhatun. Here, as far as the order and commandment is concerned, that is of the same position as that is the case of faraz. But the dalil or the source, mean the text of Quran and Sunnah, yes, that is not the only meaning of that text. But it could be explained in a different way as well. So that makes a confusion. That makes it confusion. So because of that confusion, it degraded from the status of faraz to the status of wajib. Got it? From the status of faraz to the status of wajib. Got it? Number three, that is sunnah muwakkada, or highly recommended practice. وَهُوَ مَا وَاظَبَ عَلَيْهِ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَعَ تَرْكِهِ مَرَّةً أَوْ مَرَّتَيْنِ. That sunnat muwakkad is that practice which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to do. Yes, he missed it once or twice in his lifetime. He missed it once or twice in his lifetime. And number four, that is called mandub or mustahab or nafal. Wahua ma qatfa alahu rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam marra wa tarakahu ukhra wa raghaba fihi. That is such a practice which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sometime practiced, sometime he missed it, but he mentioned that this is something very much liked. That's called targhib. Yes, he tried to persuade people towards that, to practice it. So that is called nafal, or mandub, or mustahab. Number five, that is haram. وَهُوَ مَا طَلَبَ الشَّرْعُ تَرْكَهُ تَرْكًا حَتْمًا. That is such a practice which the Sharia prohibited. Yes, period. Prohibited? Period. And number six, makruh at-tahrimi. Makruh tahrimi. And this term is, according to Hanafites, or our school of jurisprudence, وَهُوَ مَا طَلَبَ الشَّرْعُ تَرْكَهُ تَرْكًا حَتْمًا بِدَلِيلٍ زُنِّيٍ فِيهِ شُبْهَا. Yes, Sharia asked us or ordered us not to do that, but the text which is there in this regard, it has another explanation as well. Yes, which brings a confusion therein. So that's why we cannot call it haram, we call it makruh tahrimi. And number seven, makruh tanzihi. According to Jumhur, this is the only makruh. But tahrimi and tanzihi, this difference or distinction is only according to Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmatullahi alayh. So makruh tanzihi, we have to define according to Abu Hanifa, huwa ma talaba shar'u tarkahu talaban ghayra jazimin. That is such a thing which the Sharia asked us not to do, asked us not to do, but that asking of Sharia is not in a certain form. It is not in a certain form. Yes, as we use a word, I wish you should not have done it. Yes, I wish, you should not have done it. So this means, this is makruh tanzihi. Yes. And number eight, that is called mubah, or jaiz, permissible. That is such a practice where there is an option to do or not to do. To do or not to do. Yes. To drink a cup of tea in sahur, that is permissible. That's up to you. To drink it or not to drink it. Nobody can say that taking tea in sahur, that is wajib or that is sunnah or that is mustahab. Yes, according to Pashtun, that is faraz. Yes. They cannot do sahur, but they have to take a cup of tea. Got it? So now this is the preface. Now we are going ahead towards our topic, and that is the topic of Salatul Witr. The word witr, W-I-T, R, or watr, W-A-T, R, witr. Literally it means odd, O-D-D, odd number. Then it became the name of a specific prayer which rakats are odd in number. Rakats are odd in number. So that is called Salatul Witr. Now first of all, we will talk about the status or position of Salatul Witr as far as the jurisprudence terminology is concerned, that this is faraz, this is wajib, this is sunnah, or this is nafal. So before we say that, let's know one other difference between Abu Hanifa and Jumhur. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, he is making distinction between faraz and with wajib. Faraz and wajib. While Jumhur, they use the term faraz and wajib for one and the same thing. When they say faraz, it means wajib. When they say wajib, it means faraz. They do not differentiate. They say faraz and wajib both are one and the same term. Got it? Yes, for something which is highest in status than sunnati muakkad, but lower in status than faraz, they used to call it akadus sunan. They used to call it akadus sunan, extraordinary. We were talking about Salatul Witr, and we were there in the first point, and that was, what is the status or position of Salat-e Witr? So there we mentioned very clearly that actually the difference in this regard between Abu Hanifa rahimahullah and other three imams of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that is issue of semantics, which means that they are using different terms. So that's why we can see obviously a difference between Abu Hanifa and Jumhur. And that is that Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, based on Islamic jurisprudence, he classifies the ibadat or the ahkam and rules into faraz and wajib as far as mandatory or compulsory practice is concerned. But Jumhur, they do not differentiate between faraz and wajib. They say faraz and they say wajib, and by both they mean one and the same thing. Mandatory practice. Professor, come here. Jazakallah. So, for such a thing which is wajib according to Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayh, Jumhur do mention the same with another term which is a type of sunnah, but only a little bit difference between sunnati muwakkad and that type of sunnah. They use elective adjective for the same purpose and they say akadu sunan. So akad is the af'alu tafzeel of muwakkad. So muwakkad mean highly recommended, and akad mean extraordinarily highly recommended. Got it? Which is almost like wajib according to Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. So now witr is wajib according to Imam Abu Hanifa, and that is akadu sunan according to Jumhur. And in this regard, we have mentioned 5 riwayat or ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which the Jumhur has taken a plea that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not make it a wajib. We say, yes, you are right, because to you wajib mean faraz. To you wajib mean faraz. And to Hanafiya, wajib doesn't mean faraz. That is less than faraz, but up than sunnati muwakkad. So for Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, also we have mentioned 5 ahadith, which in one way or the other indicates or embodies that witr is not sunnati muwakkad, but that is a little bit higher than sunnati muwakkad, but that is not faraz as well. So for the said purpose, Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, he used the word wajib. Now point number 2, and that is, how many rakat is a salati witr? So according to Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi, witr is 1 rakat. Witr is 1 rakat after 2 sunnah of Salatul Isha. 4 faraz, then 2 sunnah, then after that is 1 rakat according to Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi. وَيَفْصِلُ بَيْنَ رَكَعَتَي sunnah وَرَكَعَتِ الْوِتْرِ بِسَلَامٍ. And they may separate the 2 sunnah of Isha and the 1 rakat of witr by what? By a salam. وَيَقْرَأُ فِيهَا بِالْإِخْلَاصِ وَالْمُعَوَّزَتَيْنِ. And in this prayer, yes, the recommended recitation is Surat al-Ikhlas, Surat al-Falaq, and Surat an-Nas. Surat al-Ikhlas, Surat al-Falaq, and Surat an-Nas. According to Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Rahmatullahi alayh, he says, recommended is that witr is one rakat, but that is also permissible to pray three rakat or more than three even. Imam Shafi says, Rahimahullah, that at least witr is one rakat, and at most that is 11 rakat. But he says, if somebody is going to pray 11, so for him, this is must to make the intention of witr in the last three rakat, even though he will be praying two separate and one separate. You should write it. As far as the case of other eight is concerned, they can pray those eight rakat either with the intention of sunnah or with the intention of nafal. But in the end last three rakat, two must be with the intention of witr, then one must be with the intention of witr. Got it? And there may be a salam in between two and one rakat. Now Imam Shafi rahmatullahi alayh, he has taken his plea based on a riwayah narrated by Hafiz ibn Hibban rahmatullahi alayh. And as you know, that a type of book in ahadith is called as-sahih. Inshallah after Ramadan, when we will restart our hadith class, there we'll be mentioning that the books of ahadith, terminologically, it has different name. Why the book of Imam Abu Dawood is called Sunan and not Sahih? Got it? Why the book of Imam Malik is called Muwatta and not Jami'? Got it? Why the book of Hakim is called Mustakhraj and not Sahih? For example. Got it or not it? So there are different terms. Sahih, Jami', Sunan, Muwatta, Musannaf, Mustakhraj, Mustadrak, Atraf, Ilal. Got it? Nuruddin, we will take you to a new ocean. Yes. This is a different ocean. Yes? But there are pearls. There are pearls. Lot of pearls are there when we will go to that ocean, inshallah. So anyhow, Ibn Hibban rahmatullahi alayh, he has written a book in hadith that is called Sahih of Ibn Hibban. And later on we will talk about that. That there are a lot of sahih, like Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, there is Sahih al-Hakim, Sahih of Ibn Khuzaimah, Sahih of Ibn Hibban. These three, beside Bukhari and Muslim, these three are very famous. Sahih of Hakim, Sahih of Ibn Hibban, and Sahih of Ibn Khuzaimah. Got it? Got or not it? Yes. So Ibn Hibban rahmatullahi alayh, in his Sahih, he narrated a hadith that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana yafsilu bayna ash-shaf'i wal-witr. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to separate between odd and even, between odd and even, which means he was praying two rakat, then making salam, and then one rakat. So this is the base of the mazhab of Imam Shafi, rahmatullahi alayh. Got it? But now, when he said that witr is only one rakat, the last one, so what is the base of this saying? Got it? So there is a hadith narrated by Imam Muslim from Abdullah ibn Umar and Abdullah ibn Abbas.
Abdullah ibn Umar and Abdullah ibn Abbas. And the witr rak'atun min akhir al-layl. That witr is one rakat in the end of the night and in the last part of the night. Also, for Imam Shafi, the hadith which we have narrated before, and that is the hadith of Abu Ayyub Ansari, radiyallahu ta'ala an, in which he said, Al-Witru Haqqun, Witr is Wajib. We have narrated that hadith as a plea for Abu Hanifa. That Witr is? Because the word Haqq means Wajib. Al-Witru Haqqun, فَمَنْ أَحَبَّ يُوتَرَ بِخَمْسٍ فَلْيَفْعَلْ وَمَنْ أَحَبَّ يُوتِرَ بِثَلَاسٍ فَلْيَفْعَلْ وَمَنْ أَحَبَّ يُوتِرَ بِوَاحِدَةٍ فَلْيَفْعَلْ. That witr is wajib. So whosoever likes to pray five, he can do that. And whosoever want to pray three, he can do that. And whosoever want to pray one, he can do that. So the last part of the hadith of Abu Ayyub, that is another plea for Imam Shafi, Rahmatullahi Alayh. That witr is one rakat. Got it? Also Ibn Hibban narrated another hadith from Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. Anna an-nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam salla wa awtara bi wahida. That Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed and he did itar. You should write the word. He did. Because that is our plea. So that's why we translate it. Wa'autara. And he did itar. And he did itar by one. He did itar. So now look, you have to notice my word because I'm Hanafi. Yes? Wa'autara bi wahida. And he did itar not with one. The letter ba, it means with and it means by. It means with and it means by. Now Shawafi will say with one and we say by one. He did itar with one. According to Imam Shafi, he said that witr is one because by is in the meaning of with and we say by is in the meaning of by, by. Yes, and he did itar with one. Got it? Nuruddin, got it? This is law. Because in law, every single word that is meant, it means something. With me, even comma means a lot. Yes, sometime comma hangs someone in a court of law. Yes, but only one comma. Yes. What it does?
Big difference.
Yes, big difference. It hangs someone. Yes, and sometime the same comma is giving acquittal to someone. Yes, that comma is there. What is there? Comma is there. It created a doubt. We cannot go for capital punishment. Yes, let him go home. Got it? Not it, bought it or got it?
Got it.
Okay. How you bought it? How much you paid for? Not even a single penny. And it's coming in record, so people will be saying that Qadir Sahib is charging his students for teaching because Saifullah said bought it. Say sorry.
Sorry.
So anyhow, this sorry is such a word in English that my grandkids, when they fight with each other, so one is crying and comes to me and says that she did to me like this, but she never said sorry. Yes. So the whole cry is for one word. Sorry. Yes. To say sorry. Say okay. Imam says, Rahimahullah, Abu Hanifa Rahmatullahi Alayhi, that witr is three rakat without any separation in between with salam. So first of all, we will present those hadiths or riwayat which mentions three rakat. And later on, we will mention how these three rakat were. Number one, three rakat, because others also say that three rakat is there, but there is separation with salam. Got it? Number one, Muhammad ibn Ali, from his father Ali, from his grandfather ibn Abbas, Muhammad ibn Ali, from his father, Ali, from his father, Ibn Abbas, from Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Ibn Abbas said that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I think we mentioned it before, that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he woke up at night, you should write it. So he did miswak, then he made wudu, and then he prayed 2 rakat. Then he slept. Then woke up. Then made wudu and prayed 2 rakat. He did it 3 times. So he completed 6 rakat. He did it 3 times. Completed 6 rakat. Summa awtara bi salasin wa salla rakatain. And then he did itar by 3 rakat. He did itar by 3 rakat. And then he prayed 2 rakat. Then he prayed itar by 3 rakat. And then he prayed 2 rakat. Rawahu Muslim wa Nisa'i. Rawahu Muslim wa Nisa'i. Number 2. Yahya ibn al-Jazzar. Yahya ibn al-Jazzar. Narrated from Abdullah ibn Abbas. And maybe I told you or not. Date. I read it many times that Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayh, whenever he was putting a hadith sahih in his sahih, hadith sahih, in his sahih, and these hadiths are 3000 plus, 3000 plus. When you will drop the repetition, will drop repetition. Because sometime Imam Bukhari, he narrates one hadith for more than 20 times in 20 different chapters. In 20? Different. And that is one and the same hadith. So when you drop the repetition, so these are 3000 plus. So anyhow, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayh, for every hadith, he used to make 2 rakat and then to sleep and to have an inspiration from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that carry on, that what I said or what I did. Got it? Yeah. So as you know, that these are certain, something metaphysical. Even though there is physical world and there is metaphysical, and metaphysical is much more vaster than the physical world. Got it? But as you know, that our approach is limited. So things were roaming around in my mind. Oh, ya subhanallah, for more than 3,000 times he got inspired by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes? So I told you that in one hadith, there was one Ravi. I was reading it, Qala haddathana Abdul Kareem. Qala haddathana Abdul Kareem. That this hadith we have been given by Shaykh Abdul Kareem. So by the name of Abdul Kareem, there are a few narrators. There are a few narrators. And mostly the muhaddiseen, they mention the nickname yet to differentiate between Abdul Kareem and Abdul Kareem. That which Abdul Kareem? Al-Kandahari or Peshawri? Yes? So they put the nickname to differentiate that this is Abdul Kareem from Kandahar. This Abdul Kareem is from Peshawar. And that one is from Tehrat. So anyhow, got it? So qala haddathana Abdul Kareem. So he was confused, which Abdul Kareem this Ravi is? Because as long as you have not found out the Ravi, you cannot decide that what is the status of this hadith. What is the status of this hadith? So he was confused in date Abdul Kareem, and I was consulting various books to find out, but nothing I can could find there in the books of Asma'ur Rijal. Books of Asma'ur Rijal. So even though I did not pray 2 rakat like Imam Bukhari, because I am not that pious. Yes, but anyhow, after Salat Isha, I went to my bed. When I slept, yes, so someone who I didn't see, who was there, but someone, he said, وَقَالَ إِبْنُ كِسَانَ وعبد الكريم هو الجزار. وقال ابن كيسان وعبد الكريم هو الجزار. That Allama Ibn Kisan says that this Abdul Karim is Al-Jazzar, the nickname. This Abdul Karim is Al-Jazzar because he was Qasab. He was doing his business of meat. So that's why the Ravi is called Abdul Karim Al-Jazzar. Or even his family, they were from Jazzarin. So that's why he was called Abdul Karim Al-Jazzar. Yes. So he said, yes, astaghfirullah al-azim al-lazi la ilaha illa al-hayy al-qayyum wa atubu ilayh. Why this confusion was in my mind about Imam Bukhari? Rahmat. So it means that Imam Bukhari was a very great man. Got it? That was the karama of whom? That was the miracle of Imam Bukhari. He showed me that, look, you are that small guy. You know, you are lower than my shoe even. And look how someone is inspiring you about Abdul Karim. That Abdul Karim is Al-Jazzar. Got it? Not it? Got it? But it.
Not it.
So Yahya ibn al-Jazzar, he narrates from Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray at night 8 rakat. Should write it. And doing itar by 3. And praying 2 rakat before Salat al-Fajr. Which is Sunnah. Before Salat al-Fajr mean? 2 rakat Sunnah. Rawahu al-Nisai wa al-Tahawi. Hadith is narrated by Imam Nisai and Imam Tahawi. And you know Tahawi is authentic authority in Fiqh Hanafi. Yes. The authentic authority in Fiqh Shafi is Imam Muzani. Who? Muzani. Like Abu Yusuf and Muhammad, who compiled the work of Imam Abu Hanifa. Who compiled the work of Imam Shafi? Imam Muzani. Yes. Imam Muzani. He compiled the work of Imam Shafi. Rahmatullah. We can say that the work of Imam Shafi is alive because of Imam Muzani. Got it? This also a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a great sheikh has a student like Abu Yusuf and Muhammad or like Imam Muzani. Got it? So he compiled all his work, which is known all over the world, Fiqh al-Imam al-Shafi. Fiqh al-Imam al-Shafi. So this Imam Tahawi, he is the nephew of Imam Muzani. He is what? The nephew, the son of his sister. And he was grown up in the house of Imam Muzani because he was yatim. He was yatim. So Imam Muzani was taking care of his nephew Imam Tahawi. But Imam Muzani was very strictly committed to fiqh of Imam Shafi. Even though he was a great man, so he was mentioning the pleas of Imam Abu Hanifa about every issue also. That Imam Abu Hanifa said regarding the issue like this, based on a hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn Masud radiallahu ta'ala an, or based on a hadith narrated by Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala an. Because most of the fiqh of Imam Abu Hanifa is based on the riwayat of Ibn Masud or Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. Yes, but as he was Shafi, so he was bound to prefer what? His own fiqh or Imam Shafi. So then he was answering the pleas of Abu Hanifa. But our answer to Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi is like this. You know what I'm saying? So Imam Tahawi used to do reasoning with him. Imam Tahawi used to do reasoning with them. But Mama, what is? But Mama, the hadith which is narrated by Abdullah ibn Masud radiallahu ta'ala an, that is very much clear in this issue. And as far as this answer from your side is concerned, does not make sense to me. Yeah. So Imam Muzani, rahmatullah, he was a great man, but he lost his temper. He said, get out of my class. Stand up. Yes, he turned him out of his class. He turned him out of. And Imam Tahawi joined the Hanafi school of jurisprudence. He joined what? The Hanafi school, Sawar Sheikh Mawlana Abdul Haq Sahib rahmatullah alayh. He used to say that Imam Muzani caused a trouble to himself. He caused a trouble to himself. So anyhow, Imam Tahawi rahmatullahi alayh, he's a great man.
And as you know that in Aqaid, the second ever famous book is Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyyah. Yes, and that's authentic to all four school of jurisprudence. In Aqidah and Ulum al-Kalam, yes, the same Imam Tahawi is the Imam of Shawafi, he is the Imam of Malikiyah, he is the Imam of Hanabila, he is the Imam of Hanafiyyah. So it's called Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyyah. So it means that our Aqidah is very strong, because the first ever book was written by whom? By Imam Abu Hanifa. By who? By Imam Abu Hanifa, which is? Al-Fiqh al-Akbar. And the second authentic book in Aqaid is written by Imam Tahawi, Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyyah. So sometime later we will start that book as well. Yes, if you have time. Yes. Number three, Sa'id ibn Jubayr narrated from Abdullah ibn Abbas. That Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do witr by three. Are you to do itar by three? Reciting in first rakat, Sabbih isma rabbikal a'la, Suratul A'la. In second rakat, Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun. And in third rakat, Qul huwa Allah wahad. Rawahu ad-Darimi wa at-Tirmizi. Rawahu ad-Darimi wa at-Tirmizi. And you know, I told you, I think, in Hadith class, that four Huffaz are known for Hifz Hadith. Four Hafiz are known for Hifz Hadith. Number one, Imam Bukhari. Number two, Imam Muslim. Number three, Hafiz Abu Zur'a. Hafiz Abu Zur'a. And by the name of Abu Zur'a, there are five Muhaddisin. There are five Muhaddisin. There are what? Five Muhaddisin. And this one, Abu Zur'a, is Ubaidullah ibn Abdul Karim. His name is Ubaidullah ibn Abdul Karim. Yes, so Hafiz Abu Zur'a. And number four, Abu Abdul Rahman al-Darimi. Number four, Abu Abdul Rahman al-Darimi. So this hadith is narrated by Imam Abu Abdul Rahman al-Darimi and Imam Tirmizi. Got it? Also by Imam Nisai, Ibn Majah, Tahawi, Ibn Abi Shayba, Ibn Hazm, he is the Imam of Zahiriya. He is the Imam of who? Zahiriya. And our Shaykh used to say that Qalamhu Kasayfi Hajjaj. Qalamhu Kasayfi Hajjaj. He was a very great scholar, but he did not believe in taqleed of any imam. He did not believe in taqleed of any imam. And he is that strict in this regard that he said that shirk. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. He said that is shirk. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. I don't know such a great alim how he got stuck in this point. Yeah. And he has famous books. He has. His famous book is Al-Muhalla ibn Hazm. Al-Muhalla ibn Hazm. So anyhow, Hafiz ibn Hazm, rahmatullahi alayh, from Zahiriya, he narrated that hadith. Ibn Hajar said that this hadith is sahihul isnad according to Imam Nawawi. This hadith is sahihul isnad according to Imam Nawawi. Number four, Amir al-Shabi. Amir al-Shabi says, I asked Ibn Abbas and Ibn Umar both, how was the prayer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at night? Mean tahajjud. Mean? At night prayer. Night prayer is what? So they both said, 13 rakat. 8, then he did itar by 3, and then 2 rakat after dawn break, which is sunnah.
Sunnah Fajr. So it means Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to do tahajjud a little bit before dawn break. A little bit before dawn break. Because later on we will talk about that. That Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when, look at me, when he prayed his salat tahajjud, and he prayed after salat tahajjud witr. What? Witr. So Sayyida Aisha says, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then for a while, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he laid down on the ground on his right side for a while, not sleeping, only like this. And then dawn was broken, so he stood up and he prayed two rakat sunnah. He prayed two rakat sunnah. In another hadith, the same Aisha says, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed tahajjud, then witr, then dawn was broken. So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prayed two rakat sunnah of fajr. Summastaja ala yameenihi. Summastaja ala yameenihi. And I saw my sheikh, rahmatullahi alayh, because these mashayikh, they are very practical. These mashayikh, they are very practical. I saw both of my mashayikh, rahimahullah, Mawlana Abdul Hadi sahab, rahmatullahi alayh, and Mawlana Abdul Haq sahab, rahmatullahi alayh, that at night, when they prayed tahajjud, and they did witr. So sometime they use to do after witr like this before dawn break. Yes, and then stood up and prayed two sunnat of fajr. And sometime they used to do the same after two sunnat of fajr. Yes, to practice both ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, they are awliya. They are. Huh? Mafum. Yes, and we are awliya. Subhanallah. Rawahu al-Tahawi. Hadith is narrated by? Number 5. Sabit al-Banani, he is the student of Anas ibn Malik. Thabit al-Banani. He says, Anas said to me, O Thabit, memorize it from me. You cannot have this from anyone else more authentic than me in this regard. And that's why? Because Anas used to stay in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to pray tahajjud where? In home. So that's why Anas radiallahu ta'ala says, in this regard you cannot find any authentic authority than mine. So memorize it from me. And not only that, with ihtimam, with due importance he mentioned, إِنِّي أَخَذْتُ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَأَخَذَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ عَنْ جِبْرِيلِ وَأَخَذَهُ جِبْرِيلِ عَنِ اللَّهِ. That I learnt it from Rasulullah. Rasulullah learnt it from Jibreel. Jibreel took it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes? So he was drawing the attention of Thabit al-Banani that the case is very important. That the case is? So what he told me? He told me, summa salla bi al-isha. Then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam led me in salat al-isha. Summa salla sitta rakatin. Then he prayed 6 rakat. Then he prayed 6 rakat. Yusallimu baina kulli rakatin. After every 2 rakat he was making a salam. So after Isha 6 rakat, 2 were sunnat muwakkad and other 4 were tahajjud. Other 4 were tahajjud. Summa awtara bi salasin. Then he did itar by 3. يُسَلِّمُ فِي آخِرِهِنَّ. And he made salam in the end. رَوَاهُ الرُّوْيَانِ. Imam Royani narrated hadith. وَإِبْنُ عَسَاكِر. Also, Hafiz ibn Asakir. He is also Hafiz. Hafiz ibn Asakir. His book is also called Musnad ibn Asakir. Musnad ibn Asakir. وَرِجَالُهُ السُّقَاتِ. All its narrator are authentic. All its narrator are authentic. Who said it? I cannot say it. You should write, you should keep in mind. I cannot say it. Yes, I have to find it from someone who is authentic authority in this regard. That all the narrator are authentic. ورجال سقاط كذا في كنز العمال كذا في كنز العمال امام علي متقي who said it علي متقي علي متقي is authority he's written famous book سبحان الله I'm waiting for يحيى he will bring it because he called from Syria that I forgot the name I said don't forget the name yes and the other one you cannot find No, so just take that other address from Zulfiqar, the Texas one. They have it. Mm-hmm. That's why I give him the name. Because I found in their catalog, Jami'ul Masanid. Because I'm not looking neither for car, nor for aircraft, nor for anything else. What I'm looking for?
Books.
Only books, yes. Dr. Sahib, what I'm looking for? Because these are our awzar, these are our tools. Yes, the tools of engineer are different. The tools of doctor, different. And what are the tools of mullah?
Books.
Yes. So Jami'ul Masanid. So anyhow, وَرِجَالُ سُقَاطْ كَنْزُ الْعُمَّالِ كَذَا قَالَهُ عَلِيَ الْمُتَّقِي And كَنْزُ الْعُمَّالِ is a book. If you will put it in a cabinet, it will start there from coming up to here. SubhanAllah. كَنْزُ الْعُمَّالِ Number six. Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi in his Muwatta narrated a hadith qala akhbarana Abu Hanifa. What he said? Akhbarana Abu Hanifa. Qala haddathana Abu Ja'far al-Imam Muhammad al-Baqir. You know what I'm saying? He is the Imam of who? Uddin. Huh, of Rawafiz. He is the Imam of whom?
Rawafiz.
He is the Imam of Shia. He is authentic authority, Imam Abu Ja'far Muhammad al-Baqir. Rahmatullahi alayh. He is from Ahl Bayt, from the offspring of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Imam Abu Ja'far Muhammad al-Baqir. They call him Imam Baqir. They call him what? Imam Baqir. And he was a teacher of Abu Hanifa, rahmatullahi alayh. He was a teacher of Abu Hanifa. I visited that madrasa and that room where Imam Ja'far Imam Muhammad al-Baqir used to sit and Imam Abu Hanifa was studying with him. So I sat there for a while. They told, yeah, SubhanAllah, my Imam was sitting here. And he was studying under Imam Muhammad al-Baqir here. قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا أَبُو جَعْفَرَ لِمَحَمْ مُحَمَّدْ الْبَاقِرِ أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَانَ يُصَلِّي مَا بَيْنَ صَلَاةِ الْعِشَاءِ إِلَى صَلَاةِ الصُّبْحِ صَلَاةَ عَشَرَ رَكَعَةٍ ثَمَانَ رَكَعَاتٍ تَطَوُّعًا وَصَلَاةَ رَكَعَاتِ الْوِتْرِ وَرَكَعَاتِ الْفَجْرِ رَوَاهُ مُحَمَّدْ فِي الْمُوَطَّأِ That Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in between Isha and Fajr, in between Isha and Fajr, he used to pray 13 rakat, 8 nafal, 3 witr, 2 sunnah Fajr. Number 7. Abu Salama ibn Abdul Rahman, who? Abu Salama ibn Abdul Rahman. Abdul Rahman was the son of Abu Bakr. He was the brother of Aisha. He is narrating so many hadith from his sister. So this is the nephew of Sayyida Aisha, Abu Salama. He is the son of Abdul Rahman. Abu Salama ibn Abdul Rahman. Annahu sa'ala Aisha radiyallahu anha. That I asked my sister, Sayyida Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha. My auntie. Abu Salama says, I asked my auntie, كَيْفَ كَانَ صَلَاتُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ فِي رَمَضَان How was the prayer of the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the month of Ramadan? And this is the hadith, yes, which has been explained in a wrong way. That how was the prayer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Ramadan? So Sayyida Aisha says, مَا كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ يَزِيدُ فِي رَمَضَانُ وَلَا فِي غَيْرِهِ عَلَىٰ 11 رَكَعَةٍ Prophet ﷺ was not doing more than 11 rakat, neither in Ramadan nor in other months. You should write it. He was not doing more than 11 rakat, neither in Ramadan nor in any other month. Yusalli arba'an. He used to pray 4 rakat. فَلَا تَسْأَلْ عَنْ حُسْنِهِنَّ وَطُولِهِنَّ. Don't ask me how beautiful these 4 rakat were and how long these were. Sayyidah Aisha says, I cannot tell you how beautifully he was praying these 4 rakat and how long he was praying. Then he was praying 4 rakat. So again, I cannot tell you how beautifully he was praying. And then he was praying 3 rakat witr. Then he was praying 3 rakat witr. Hadith is narrated by Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawood, Nisai, and Ahmad. And this is the hadith people are taking because of laziness, nothing else. Yes. This is not a case of something else. Yes. This is a case of what? Laziness. That oh, Taraweeh is 8 rakat. Taraweeh? Why? Because Abu Salama asked Aisha radiallahu ta'ala about the prayer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at night in Ramadan. And he said Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not doing more than 11 rakat neither in Ramadan nor in other months. Yes. So if that is 8 rakat in Ramadan, so what was that in other than Ramadan? Yes. Because Aisha says, neither in Ramadan nor in other than Ramadan. If that is 8 rakat in Ramadan and there's Taraweeh, so what he was doing in other? Yes. So there is no way but to say, oh, in other months that was tahajjud. So it means he was not praying tahajjud in Ramadan then. Does it make sense? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was much more eager regarding ibadat in the month of Ramadan. So in other months, he was praying tahajjud in Ramadan. Yes, so that's why all 4 school of jurisprudence, they say that this hadith has nothing to do with Taraweeh. This is not related to Taraweeh. Yes, and that's why except Imam Bukhari, except Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayh, all muhaddiseen, except Imam Bukhari, all muhaddiseen, they have written 2 chapters. They have written 2 chapters. One chapter is called Babu Maja fi Qiyam al-Layl. Babu Maja fi Qiyam al-Layl. And the other one is Babu Maja fi Salat al-Taraweeh. So it means that according to all muhaddiseen, Salat al-Taraweeh is different prayer and Qiyam al-Layl is different prayer. Yes, we'll talk about Taraweeh inshallah. Should we? Nuruddin say no, should not. Okay. Huh? Okay. Number 8. Abdul Aziz ibn Juraij. Who? Abdul Aziz ibn Juraij. He says, I asked Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, bi ayy shay'in kana Rasulullah yutir. With which part of Holy Quran Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was praying his witr? Which part of Holy Quran he was praying? His witr. So she said, كان يقرأ في الأولى بسبح اسم ربك الأعلى وفي الثانية بقول يا أيها الكافرون وفي الثالثة بقول هو الله أحد والمعوذتين. That he was reciting in first rakat سبح اسم ربك الأعلى, in second rakat قول يا أيها الكافرون, and in third rakat Surah Al-Ikhlas, and both معوذتين قول الله أحد قول أعوذ بالفلق قول أعوذ برب الناس. رواه الترمذي وقال هذا حديث غريب. Imam Tirmidhi narrated hadith and he said this hadith is غريب. Not غريب that this hadith does not have money. Yes. This is غريب as far as the case of usul al-hadith is concerned. Number 9. Amra. That is the niece of Sayyida Aisha. So yeah, subhanallah, what a lady Sayyida Aisha was. How she trained her nephews and nieces. Yes, all of them, they used to stay in the house of Aisha. Not for sheesh kebab or roast chicken or things like that. Yes, because Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha,
She was the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She was a lady having a lot, yes, but doing her breakfast or her dinner or her lunch with dry barley bread with water sometime. Yes. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Usman, Sayyidina Ali used to send her a lot. Used to send her a lot. That these are $10,000. Take it to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. But what she was doing? Yes, she used to tell Urwa. Urwa is her nephew as well. That Urwa, come here. Yes. Take these 2,000 to Ashabu Sufa. The students are sitting there. Give it to them. They should distribute it. And Urwa, come on. You know the zone of Ansar? He said, yes. These 5,000, just go there and distribute in their houses. Yes. So once she distributed in one day 30,000 dinar. How many? 30,000. And when Urwa came home, so he was looking for food. So there was dry bread of barley and vinegar. Dry bread of barley and vinegar. And at the same time, Sayyida Aisha told him that, Urwa, just have your food. I have a little bit money to take it to someone. Yes. So when Urwa was taking money, he came out of his house. He talked to someone. He was a young man. He was a young man. So he said that, my auntie, she is going to kill us of hunger. Yes. Giving everything to people. And we don't have anything. We don't have anything to what? To eat. So Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, yes, she took an oath in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I will never talk to Urwa. That I will never talk to Urwa. Why he said it? Yes, I am here in this world to eat, to enjoy my life, to collect money, to make bank balance, to make properties. Urwa is staying in my house for food. Yes, so she took an oath in the name of Allah, I will never talk to Urwa. Got it? And then Urwa was almost dying of that oath of Aisha. Yes, that what can I do? How I will remake it? How I will make her happy again? Yes, because I was only joking. And she heard it. You know what I'm saying? So somebody told him that, look, there is only one way. There is only one way, intercession. What?
Intercession.
He said to Sayyida Aisha, who will intercede for me? Who will go to talk to my auntie in this regard? Nobody, even major sahaba, they are not going to Sayyida Aisha because of respect of Sayyida Aisha, that she is our mother. How we can approach her in this regard? How we can convince her? Yes. So somebody told him, if you will take Imam Hassan and Hussein with you, yes, so you will see. You will see, because she will recall her mind that how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in love with these two. Yes, so Urwa came to Imam Hassan and was like, brother, please, for the sake of Allah, he is very angry with me. So he took them both. He took them both. And they didn't say anything. Yes, but they went there and they said, Mom, we came with Urwa. Yes.
She got the point.
Yes. We came with Urwa. So Sayyida Aisha, she was a very talented lady. She said, okay, done. I will pay my kafara. But Urwa, next. Urwa says, Astaghfirullah, if I will conceive later on about that. But this time you please forgive me. Got it? So Amra radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was also the daughter of Abdul Rahman ibn Abu Bakr. Amra binti Abdul Rahman. Amra binti Abdul Rahman. And that's what I told you, that Imam Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu ta'ala said to Muhammad ibn Muslim ibn Shahab al-Zuhari, yes, it compiled me the hadith of Amra from Aisha. The hadith of Amra, in compilation of hadith, I have mentioned that. But I told you that you should not write, only memorize. Ma naqalahu adlun. Huh? Say.
تام الضبط ها بسند متصل من غير شذوذ ولا عله. So everything should be memorized in such a way. So this is another point that he wrote to Muhammad ibn Muslim Shahab al-Zuhri, that write down for me and compiled in a separate book the hadith of Amra from Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Got it? As his father, Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan, his father, Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan, he wrote to Muhammad ibn Muslim ibn Shahab al-Zuhri, rahmatullahi alayh, that write down for me and compile the hadith of Abu Huraira. The hadith of Abu Huraira. So how the Mustashrikeen did a wrong interpretation, that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, yes, he was not believing in the hadith of Abu Huraira. So when he asked Muhammad ibn Muslim Shahab al-Zuhri to write down and compile the hadith, he said, accept a hadith of Abu Huraira. Accept a hadith of Abu Huraira. So you can twist it in one way or the other. Yes, when you have enmity with someone, so you can twist it. Somebody who has enmity with the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he can twist it. Let it mean Abu Huraira is not trustworthy. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We say, brother, look into the history. Because Abdullah Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, already he had that compiled book of Abu Huraira, which was written by his father. Which was written? So something which you have, do you need it again? Yes, got it? So Amra, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, she narrated from Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha, and the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana yutiru bi salas. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do witr, witri, reciting in first rakat sabbih isma rabbika al-ala, and in third rakat qul huwa Allah wahad, qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq, and qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas. Second rakat she did not mention, but in other riwayat that in second rakat he was reciting قُلْ يَا هِيُوَ الْكَافِرُونَ. هَذَا حَدِيثٌ شَحِيحٌ عَلَى شَرْطِ الشَّيْخِينَ. Hakim says that this hadith is sahih according to the conditions of Shaykhain, Imam Muslim and Imam Bukhari. Shaykhain mean like our two hafizain, they are Shaykhain. Yes. Two Shaykh are called Shaykhain. Yes. So in logic and philosophy, in what? In logic and philosophy, there is a term of Shaykhain. So when the ulama and scholars in logic and philosophy says that what Shaykhain said, this is what? Shaykhain said. So by Shaykhain, they mean Abu Nasr al-Farabi and Abu Ali ibn Sina. Abu Nasr al-Farabi and who? Abu Ali ibn Sina. They are called Shaykhain. Yes. When Muhaddisin says Rawahu Shaykhan, hadith is narrated by Shaykhain. So what they mean? Imam Bukhari and Muslim. Yes. And when Hanafiya says Haza Maqalahu Shaykhan, this is the mazhab of Shaykhain. So by Shaykhain they mean? No. Abu Hanifa and Abu Yusuf, Rahimahum Allah, they are called Shaykhain. In Fiqh Hanafiya, Shaykhain is Abu Hanifa and Imam Abu Yusuf. When they say Sahibain, so Abu Yusuf and Muhammad. When they say Tarafain, so Abu Hanifa and Muhammad. Got it? Got it or not it? When in Sahaba we say Shaykhain, Abu Bakr and Umar, radiallahu ta'ala anhumah. Got it? Not it? Or but it? Yes. So these are nine hadiths. So I will give you another list of a few. Yes, then we will go ahead that rakat are three, but how we have to pray? Two and one are all three together. So then we will go to the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and practice of Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. Then after that, we will go ahead about Dua-i Qunut. As you know, that Mawalik and Shafi'iyah, they are not reciting Dua-i Qunut in Witr the whole year. Yes, they do recite in Salat-i Fajr. They recite in Salat-i Fajr. Only in the last 15 nights of Ramadan, they do it in Witr. Got it? Yes or not? So why that? We will say that. That nobody is doing what he is doing from his own. That is the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.